It is my pleasure to introduce our next speakers, my colleagues at the University of Bonn, Christoph Ernst and Jens Schröter. Christoph Ernst is assistant professor at the Department of Media Studies at the University of Bonn. His main research interests include diagrammatic reasoning and media aesthetics of information visualization, theory of tacit knowledge in digital media, especially interface theory and artificial intelligence, media theory and media philosophy, especially media and imagination. His comprehensive study on the media aesthetics of diagrammatics is about to be published with transcript. Jens Schröter is chair for media studies at the University of Bonn. He has extensively published on a wide range of topics, including the media archaeology of three-dimensional images, media and economy, and artificial intelligence, to name just a few. His study on 3D, history, theory, and aesthetics of the transplane image has been published with Bloomsbury in 2014. Currently, he directs a planning grant on how is artificial intelligence changing science, and he is also a speaker of a research project funded by the Volkswagen Foundation, which deals with a radical future, society after money. Together, Christoph and Jens have co-authored a book on media futures, theory and aesthetics, which is forthcoming with Palgrave Macmillan and has already been published in German with Springer. Today, they will be presenting on imagining quantum computers as media technologies. Christoph and Jens, we are looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much, Dominik, for this generous introduction. And thanks, of course, to everyone that helped organizing this beautiful conference. Thank you all very, very much from us. Every major change in digital technologies, so much is obvious, promises massive transformations for society as a whole. Currently, the development of quantum computers is attracting much attention. Although, or precisely because, real-world applications of quantum computers are still rare, but at the same time promise immense potential, this topic mobilizes imaginations of various kinds. These imaginations come in the form of what Sheila Jasanoff has called, quote, socio-technical imaginaries, end of quote. Concepts established by institutions in order to mediate ideas about technological futures and their transformative effects on society. These concepts can come in form of product presentations, scientific concepts, but also in the form of fictional discourses. As an example, of course, science fiction. We had this already yesterday. In our talk, we will compare two types of such socio-technical imaginaries. In the first part, we briefly give an example for imaginaries concerning quantum computing within the scientific community itself. Namely, John Preskill's concept of, quote, noisy intermediate scale quantum technologies, end of quote. In the second part, we will look into a vision for the use of quantum computing as media in science fiction, namely Shixin Liu's trilogy, Remembrance of Earth's Past, and his idea of so-called softens.
Thank you, Jens. In September 2019, there was evidence that a Google research team had achieved an epoch-making breakthrough in the sphere of quantum computing, the so-called quantum supremacy. A flood of articles soon followed in which the supposed sensation was interpreted. The tenor was that Google's team might have proven that the vision of a quantum computer was gradually transforming into a technological reality with potentially massive consequences for all of society. Coined in 2012 by the physicist John Preskill, quantum supremacy describes a state in which quantum computers have significant speed advantages in doing complex calculations, while also having lower energy costs as compared to the strongest existing traditional supercomputers. In the course of expositing his criteria, Preskill, and this is important, postulates that the demonstration of quantum supremacy would show that there exists no unknown physical law which would in principle forestall the possible future supremacy of quantum computers. Once this evidence is provided, and this is exactly the claim the Google team makes, it follows that a certain era in the history of the development of quantum computers would be ushered in, namely the era of noisy intermediate scale quantum technologies, or NISQs in short. NISQ is a term that Preskill uses to describe an era in which quantum computers have between 50 and a few hundred qubits, the Google machine has 53, are superior to classic computers in terms of applications with no practical use yet, and remain noisy because the stabilization of the qubits is very susceptible to mistakes. However, once these NISQs are realized, the future of quantum computing has become a reality, and hence the future will begin. In future studies, this process is addressed with the term future rebuilds. Future rebuilds are possibilities which, due to an event like a discovery or invention, change their status from unrealizable possibilities that still lie in the distant future to realizable possibilities now looming in the near future. This changes the nature of imaginaries as well. For example, older utopias which have been regarded as possible are now of interest regarding the question how these new possibilities are developed further. This is not unlike what is going on here. The demonstration of quantum supremacy and the appearance of NISQs marks the starting point for the future of the quantum computer within the professional developer community. Yet, the indeterminacy of and alien nature of those technologies is also established, which in turn emphasizes the significance of those imaginaries currently available. As an expert, Preskill is much more reserved than most of the press articles when it comes to the future development of quantum computing. Particularly, he notes that quantum computers are much too different or too alien with respect to classic computers for us to say anything with certainty about the future development of these machines. For him, it is certainly plausible to presuppose that these machines will have massive social effects in the next decades, but to what extent these machines will influence the use of computers as media is still completely open to conjecture. Conspicuous here is that in order to compensate for this alienness of quantum computing, Preskill is also borrowing from older utopias and visions of the present classic media culture. This becomes clearer with regard to the well-known distinction between analog and digital. In Preskill's papers, different understandings of the analog-digital distinction can be observed. On the one hand, he addresses the analog characters of qubits. This would suggest that quantum computers would be paradigmatic post-digital machines. On the other hand, he considers the quantum computer to be a classic digital universal machine. With regard to simulation as one of the cause of fascination with computers in the 20th century, in our case, the simulation of complex material structures, Preskill states, for example, the following, quote, "When we speak of an analog quantum simulator, we mean a system with many qubits whose dynamics resemble the dynamics of a model system we are trying to study and understand. By contrast, a digital quantum simulator is a gate-based universal quantum computer which can be used to simulate any physical system of interest when suitably programmed and can also be used for other purposes. Analog quantum simulation has been a very vibrant area of research for the past 15 years, whereas digital quantum simulation with general purpose circuit-based quantum computers is just now getting started," unquote. Preskill is using here a variant of the analog-digital distinction, which seizes upon the model of the digital computer as a universally programmable machine and projects it onto a possible application to the new quantum technologies. This leads to a very basic and very simple observation. Although quantum computing might be too different, might be too alien, and is de facto on the level of the qubit an analog rather than a digital technology, the imaginaries of known media history are the guiding principles when it comes to questions regarding the future development of these machines. Science fiction, on the other hand, is not constrained to this way of thinking and speaking. This raises the following questions. Question: can we find more complex imaginaries of quantum computers as media in artistic contexts? We claim such ideas can be found, especially in the first part of Shishin Liu's senior futuristic trilogy, Remembrance of Earth's Past, called The Three-Body Problem.
Thank you, Christoph. Therein, Liu describes supercomputers called SOFNs. What is this supercomputer, which is in fact a quantum computer, about? SOFNs are, in the novels, subatomic quantum computers sent as sentient probes to Earth in advance of an invasion fleet by an alien species, the so-called Trisolarians. At the beginning of the book, a Chinese scientist has made radio contact with them in the aftermath of the Cultural Revolution. These SOFNs have one purpose: to interrupt human scientific progress and all defensive measures on Earth. Four SOFNs are constructed by the Trisolarians, and two of them are sent to Earth. It's very interesting to see how Shishin Liu describes these computers. There are various important aspects of the motive of the SOFN: how the SOFNs are built and how they operate. First, in order to build the SOFNs, the Trisolarians construct a particle accelerator in the orbit around their star. Using this accelerator, they are able to unfold a proton in two dimensions as a sheet in the orbit of their planet. The planet's gravity is used to stabilize the unfolded sheet. This represents the metaphor of a transformation, folding, of matter in various dimensions. Second, the interaction forces enable the Trisolarians to etch circuits onto the two-dimensional sheet and then fold the whole thing back to its subatomic size. Being small as a proton, a SOFN can reach near light speed and cross the distance to Earth in about 4 years. This represents the idea of a quantum computer built on the subatomic level. Thirdly, the two pairs of SOFNs, each consisting of one SOFN on Earth and one on Trisolaris, constitute a network which enables real-time communication via quantum entanglement. Furthermore, if one translates the original Chinese, the SOFNs have to be addressed more precisely as SOFNs with a T. The name highlights that a SOFN is a self-aware robot. In the third novel of Shishin Liu, a SOFN takes the form of a human, a young Japanese woman. This represents the motive of networked and self-aware embodied artificial intelligence. What are the abilities of SOFNs and their effect on Earth? They establish a state of total surveillance through networked computers. SOFNs have access to everything, not only to communication, but to the level of material ontology. At one point, one SOFN explicitly says, quote, "I can see everyone inside and the organs inside everyone, even the organs inside the organs," end of quote. In consequence, as German sociologist Niklas Luhmann would have said, SOFNs are able to interfere with the structural coupling between communication and consciousness. The social consequences of this are huge. SOFNs are able of total surveillance of all communication on Earth, forcing humanity into the uncomfortable situation to come up with a defensive plan without having the ability to explicitly communicate about that plan. However, while the SOFNs are able to observe communication, human thoughts are not transparent to them. SOFNs are able to create hallucinations by projecting, example given, information directly on the retina. But they are not able to telepathically read consciousness. Hence, in Shishin Liu's world, communication and consciousness remain strictly separate. It is crucial to see that SOFN is not only a political metaphor for total surveillance of communication, but also a metaphysical one, a metaphor of the computerization of matter itself. The Sophons are able to disrupt the course of human scientific progress by invalidating the results of particle accelerators, being considered in the novels as the key technology for human progress. We have the quite uncommon motive of the disruption of scientific progress by more advanced computers. Why is this important? Towards the end of the first novel, there is a dialogue in which one person states, quote, "I just want to point out this fact. In the universe, an important mark of a civilization's technological advancement is its ability to control and make use of micro dimensions," end of quote. Controlling the micro dimensions of the universe by processes of folding and unfolding matter is, in relation to quantum computing, reflected at a scale to illustrate the technological progress of a civilization.
We come to our conclusions. What do we get from these totally different imaginaries around quantum computing? Most likely, the third element necessary for comparison of the two can be found in the motive of the alienness of quantum computing. Quantum computing is, in our case, quite literally an alien technology. With regard to Shixin Liu, the motive of the Sophon consists of metaphors describing the effects of Sophon as a media technology on human social development, most prominently the necessity to cope with the total surveillance of all communication. But more importantly, Sophon is a metaphysical metaphor for technological development, for example, with regard to the crucial ability of civilizations to manipulate matter as such. These aspects are connected with regard to their media historical premises. Sophons are able to derail human progress because they seal off the future development of computing. Thus, sophons are very specific media of surveillance. The disruption of particle physics is considered to be a disruption in the research necessary to develop higher order quantum computing. Thus, a post-digital scenario in the future appears in Shixin Liu's novels as the inability of humanity to reach the next designated level of computing. This would be a level of controlling the dimensionality of matter by the use of quantum computers. This echoes surprisingly well with the real-world scientific concept of NISQs. Preskill argues that quantum supremacy is precisely defined through the fact that there is no physical law that will constrain the future development of quantum computing. Furthermore, in Preskill's text, the scenario is the exact opposite to Shixin Liu's. For Preskill, quantum computers are on the verge of becoming a usable technology. The possible future implications of quantum supremacy are staggering and concern first and foremost questions of crypto security and hence problems of surveillance. But there is a second motive which Preskill actually hints at in his text, and that is the application of quantum computing for the material sciences. Here, the relation between computing and matter comes back in. We might even speculate if the motive of Sophon as a form of quantum computing operating on the level or is operating on the level what Karen Barat has called intra-activity, that is, relations without pre-existing relata. In this light, the alienness of quantum computing might be exactly this aspect of a completely different relation between materiality and computing, hence forcing us to rethink the relation between physics and media once again. Thank you very much.